Oliver's Antiques, written by The Everyman Doctrine. I didn't mean to step into that store. It was in the middle of a commercial plaza in that purgatory-inspired part of the city squashed between downtown and the suburbs, where all of the buildings look like the American dream gone wrong. I was an accountant at a firm nearby, and part of my boring, life-sapping routine was grabbing a meatball marinara from the plaza before heading home. I opened the wrong door that time, which wasn't much of a surprise. They all looked the same shade of gruel. It didn't take me very long to figure out that this wasn't a Subway. This was one of those antique stores you'd see on neglected billboard advertisements. It was called Oliver's Antiques, which is a stupid name. The walls were fixed with glass shelves decked out with little antiques from centuries past. Victorian china sets, old nutcracker dolls, the kind of stuff that you'd imagine in some crazy-eyed psychic cat lady's house. I was about to step out when I was greeted by someone at the counter. It was a surprise that this place was staffed. A girl in her early 20s, probably working part-time there to pay back student loans or something. She had red hair and blue eyes, with a petite figure. A pretty distinctive look in this part of town. "Welcome to Oliver's Antiques," she mumbled, evidently bored by the job, but also somewhat intrigued that someone had stepped in. I felt a bit sympathetic, so I stayed for a bit, looking over the collections and asking a few odd questions here and there. More interesting than Subway, to say the very least. I'm not much of a history buff at all, but this place does have free Wi-Fi, so there's that. The most expensive thing that they had was an antebellum table from the early 1800s, selling for barely four figures. I ended up buying a little tea set for 20 bucks, mostly out of courtesy. That wasn't the last time I went to Oliver's Antiques. It was a pretty good place to wait out rush hour. Ariel, that's the shopkeeper's name, was a pretty easygoing person. We were both bored out of our minds by the end of the day, so it was nice for us to have a decent conversation. I'll be honest, I had a bit of a crush on her. She really had that girl next door thing going. Through all of these two-hour hangouts, we got to know a lot about each other, from our favorite Netflix shows to politics. One day, I got around to asking about the store itself. It was called Oliver's Antiques, but I never actually got around to meeting this Oliver. Maybe he only worked weekends. I asked Ariel about it, and her expression dropped a little. A reflex that you had to look really hard to see. "Oh, he's my dad," she said. "The store's a family business, but he's retired." I could see that the question upset her a little. Maybe they didn't get along or something. No point in me asking. After a few months of waiting around, I splashed some cold water on my face and I decided to take a chance. I asked her out and she said yes, like it was the most obvious thing in the world. After she closed down the store, we'd go back to my place together, order a pizza, watch a movie, all that good stuff. Life was great. For the first time in a long time, I had something to look forward to at the end of the day. I think that it was a day in mid-February when it happened. I finished up a bit late at work, and when I got to the antique store, it was already way past closing hours. I was going to head home when that blizzard in the weather forecast started. Before long, the roads were nearly impossible to see, and the roads were piling up with slippery, wet snow. While thinking about what to do, I saw that the open sign was shining in the distinctive red, piercing through the snowfall. There was someone standing at the counter, but the lights were too dim to see clearly. Then he walked right up to me.
"Welcome to Oliver's Antiques, young man. I'm Oliver."
You are, I said, confused. We shook hands. He was wearing a polished business suit with a distinctive retro flair, but something was off. His grip was as weak as a feather, and so was his voice. The guy looked to be no older than 20. So, Ariel's dad is either a vampire, James Charles, or a whole different kind of baby boomer.
"Come, let me take you through our collection," he said. He led me through the familiar shelves that I'd seen 1,000 times before. Except that he wasn't giving me a tour. He was just robotically walking right down the aisles. And he would have kept walking had I not followed him. He soon made an abrupt stop and opened a drawer that I had hardly ever noticed before, pulling out a cute little vase. "Our featured product," he whispered. "It's on discount. We're selling it for $10.
$10, I said. I was already put off a little by this guy's mannerisms. That just made the whole situation even more dubious. This store is selling a vase for $10, but tea sets go at $20? At that point, I was honestly too weirded out to say no. "I'll buy it," I responded, pulling out a crumpled bill. He smiled and softly but firmly uttered something along the lines of, "Use it well." He gave me a pat on the back and just stood there for a few seconds, as if collecting his thoughts. He then walked towards the door, again at that robotic pace, like he doesn't even care about his surroundings. I had a bunch of questions in my head. Above all else, does he even know that I'm with his daughter? I followed him towards the counter, but he wasn't there. The room was still dimly lit, but the lights weren't on. The light was coming from outside, where the storm had apparently winded down within minutes, with barely any snow left on the ground. The door was also locked. He sure wasn't anywhere inside. But if he had already headed out, then how did he lock the door? Ariel wasn't home. She left me a text saying that she ran into a few friends from high school and that they were going to spend some time hanging out. I sat down on the couch in the seat with the broken springs. I looked at the vase, this time under proper light, and I was taken aback. It was beautiful. The patterns were intricate beyond compare, and the exotic ornaments were of an exceptionally attentive workmanship. The whole thing exuded a unique historical flair. For $10, it was a good deal. I decided to keep it near the window. It looked nice next to the orchids that Ariel tended to. I forgot about the whole ordeal the next morning. To be honest, I didn't even notice the vase standing there. A few months had passed when one of my buddies from college came into town. He worked as an archivist because apparently a BA in history doesn't guarantee you a spot in law school anymore. We were having a nice chat when he just dropped off, staring at the vase that I had bought a few months ago. "Oh great," I thought. "Here he goes again with his history boner." He started going off about some boring ancient lore. And after what felt like an hour, he insisted that I should get it appraised. So I did. Frankly, I didn't know what I was expecting. If this thing was worth something, then maybe I'd get a better couch. If not, I could rub it in Mr. Academia's face. The appraiser guy spent a ridiculous amount of time in a room poring over the thing before stepping out and asking me where I had gotten it. When I told him that I bought it for $10 at a local antique store, he almost had a seizure. The thing was a state-of-the-art treasure from the height of the Ming Dynasty in China. I didn't understand all the details, but I did understand its value in dollars. $1 million. Now I had a working-class net worth. $1 million hit me like a wrecking ball of diamonds. Being a millionaire, that's something else. Now, it's nowhere near the Jeff Bezos kind of rich, but who would even need to be? The vase was auctioned off at an upscale venue. It was fun watching all the tasteful aristocrats of the city gathered to pay 7 figures for a glorified bottle. The auctioneers kept a share of the ultimate sales price, which I was fine with. I'm a millionaire now, I realized. I didn't know how to process that. I went home that day to surprise Ariel with the check. She was ecstatic, we both were. I told her to thank her dad for selling me this thing in the first place, and she seemed confused all of a sudden. My dad? Yeah, Oliver. I met him a few months ago at the store. He sold me the vase for $10. I tried looking for him afterwards, but he had just bailed on me. She didn't say a word. Look, I know you guys aren't close, but this thing is something else. We get to have everything that we've ever wanted, all because your dad sold this thing at a family discount, I told her. She sat there for a few minutes, without any expression, and then finally managed to squeeze something out. My dad's dead, she said. I didn't know what to say. But I saw him. I talked to him, I exclaimed. No, you don't understand. He died when I was barely a year old. And then she told me the story. Oliver wasn't always into antiques. He was a prolific gambler, living life in the fast lane. There eventually came a time when he bit off more than he could chew, owing more than he won. He was already constantly moving from country to country, so he decided to pay off his debts by becoming a tomb raider, digging up ancient mausoleums from Egypt to China. His prizes came with a price, of course. The police eventually got on his trail, not for desecrating history halfway across the world, but for a years-old drug offense. They found him dead from an overdose in a motel somewhere, trying to drown out his remorse for such a messed up life. His wife, Ariel's mother, inherited all the things that he had stolen. They were stolen treasures from abroad, but she didn't even know exactly where they had come from. So she sold them to whatever museums would take them, and then used the money to set up an antique store with what the museums wouldn't take. Ariel took over the store after her mother died a few years ago. By that point, the store had been drained of all its original assets and was barely getting by. But Oliver didn't defer all of his belongings to his wife. He left the most precious one on standby, for the one he was never there for. He waited around for all those years for someone who didn't know him to step into his store, someone who would look out for Ariel. And with the last little bit of him left in this world, as weak as a feather, he made up for the last of his trespasses. Use it well, he had said. Years later, life has changed for the better. Me and Ariel got a decent place together. We got married last year and had a baby daughter. I quit my job to start a freelance business, which is a lot easier when you've got a top-notch safety net. Ariel sold off the store. It had run its course and served its purpose. We're as happy as anyone can get. Yesterday, we took our daughter to the museum. The fat cat who bought the vase at the auction died of old age, and his family donated the collection to a museum, where the ornate piece of history was finally where it belonged, for all to see and admire. In the reflection of the protective glass, I saw a faint reflection appear. The distinctive sight of the man who had sold me that vase years ago. I saw him smile at us, beaming with pride and fulfillment. By the time I turned around, he was gone for good.